Panda, Arvind Kumar, Best Dr. Rajat Kathuria. Good morning. Is my voice loud and clear? Lovely. Hi, namaste. My name is Smita Sharma. I am a journalist consulting currently with TV9 Bharatvarsh as executive editor. I host the 9 o'clock show for them, and it's a lovely opportunity for me. Thank you, Sameer, for inviting me over to moderate this session today here at the SKOCH conference, which I think is rather topical and one of great significance. Because if you look at how things have been shaping up over the past many years now, and especially in the wake of the past few weeks, in just the recent aftermath of the monsoons, some 300 people have died across 4 states of Gujarat, Kerala, Maharashtra, and Karnataka. If you look at some of the figures, in Kerala itself last year, the floods claimed at least 450 lives. Currently, 1 million people have been displaced in these 4 states alone. I'm not even talking about the other states that have been, in the sort of caught up in floods constantly. According to an India Today report, in the last almost 65 years, India suffered damages worth 3,78,247 crores simply by virtue of floods. And India's geographical area, if you were to look at it, almost 12% of it is vulnerable to floods. So why are we talking about these figures and these statistics? Because climate change is something that nobody today is untouched from. Climate change is something that we are seeing, we are feeling, we are facing the heat of on a daily basis. I mean, today we are here at a time when, remember, the Amazon forest fires have been making it to the world headlines. 6 of the G7 leaders recently pledged $20 million to help Brazil fight those fires. Of course, the Brazilian president has been anything but cooperative. Donald Trump, the man, how can you talk about climate change and not mention the American president? He chose to miss out on the G7 summit on climate biodiversity because he cited he had meetings with Narendra Modi and Angela Merkel. But guess what? Both Merkel and Modi were actually sitting in that room discussing climate change. So wonder who was actually Donald Trump really talking about. And maybe there's a reason why Mr. Narendra Modi gave him that good pounding when he shook hands with Mr. Donald Trump. So, when you look at all of these situations, you're looking at summers, which are the hottest in 100 years now. Hum Delhi wale hain, sadi Delhi ki baat karte hain. Who doesn't face the summer heat? गर्मियों में लगता है कि सब भाग जाएं यहाँ से. 50 डिग्री टेम्परेचर आम सी बात है, मामूली सी बात है अब दिल्ली वालों के लिए. सो इंडिया इज रियली वन ऑफ द मोस्ट वल्नरेबल जोन्स इन द वर्ल्ड व्हेन वी टॉक अबाउट क्लाइमेट चेंज. एंड इट्स नॉट जस्ट वल्नरेबल, इट्स ऑल्सो वन ऑफ द हाइएस्ट इनफैक्ट डेंसिटीज व्हेन इट कम्स टू इकोनॉमिक एक्टिविटी. सो दैट मीन्स दैट द प्रेशर ऑन वाटर, एयर, सॉइल, फॉरेस्ट, दिस इज गोइंग टू बी अमंग्स द वर्स्ट इन द वर्ल्ड बाई 2020. These are reports being given out. So today, as we come here to discuss climate change challenges that face the world, that face India, especially in the wake of the $5 trillion economic ambition that the Modi government has now put forward, we will try and see what really is the way forward from here. And I'm joined here by an esteemed panel. A quick round of introduction. Mr. G.P. Panda, he's a senior fellow at the SKOCH Development Foundation, has been working on sociology issues. Dr. Rajat Kathuria is the Director and Chief Executive for the Indian Council for Research on International Economic Relations, or ICREER as we call it, has also been working prominently on sustainability issues. I'm hoping that Ms. Pooja Mehra, who's a leading prominent financial journalist and an author and is stuck somewhere in the Delhi traffic right now, will be joining us in a bit. We also have Dr. Arvind Kumar, President for India Water Foundation and Governor of the Water World Council. He's been working, in fact, massively pan-India, but also focusing a lot on the water projects in Northeast. Mr. Jay Chima, Partner Projects, Energy and Natural Resources at the Cyril Amarchand Mangaldas, will also be talking about Kanoon Ki Pechidgya with you when it comes to climate change. And Dr. Gurshiran Dhanjal, Managing Director and Chief Editor for SKOCH. So to start with you, Mr. Panda, when we talk about climate change today, just give us a brief sense, and we would like all of the panelists to make it as interactive as possible. What really are the two biggest challenges that you see for India when it comes to climate change?
Thank you. Well, basically I'm an anthropologist and social anthropologist. So when I speak something about anything, including the climate change, would be the reflection of the people with whom I work at the grassroots level. I've been working with the tribals for quite more than 3 decades. The essential concerns for them as regards to the climate change is Jal, Jameen, and Jungle. And this is the universal feature. We may ascribe it to tribal or otherwise. I have been looking at my own life experience in the village and growing up over time and space. I've seen that, you see, at one point of time, the climate was a concern of the people, which is very much in the control, in their hands. Suppose if they have to clean the village tank or the drainage to the village tank or do plantation or dig the well, that was very much within the village community. Within the village community's efforts. Now, over the years, the development process has started, be it community development or other development since third plan onwards, that somehow has detached people from their own participation in the whole process. They exceedingly become dependent upon the government programs, thinking that government is someone else, not them. So this detachment and separation has made a damaging contribution. For example, I have been working in 3-4 years and across the country. Like I was working in Northeast, in Meghalaya. Every village had a green page, a dedicated place which is related to their village deity, and everyone is to protect that place and plant trees, and this is a village community concern. But over the years, they had shifting cultivation. The shifting cultivation was prohibited because it was said that it contributes to degradation of forest. But the shifting cultivation was the only means of their sustenance. Now, in agriculture, in a shifting cultivation situation, only in 1 kilometer area, only around 50% families can sustain. Now with the growth of population, this land become like postal stamps. It's not yielding anymore. That's how they have abandoned the land and shifted to coal mining and other areas which are not conditioned.
So you are saying that these are choices that have been forced upon them. And the environmental, in fact, changes are also leading to the social ecology changing for all of them.
Yes, the 3 aspects of them. See, there is one population, the other is environmental, and the social organization, which is instrumental in production and consumption. Okay. So these 3 effects have greatly affected the climatic change, and the people being in the center stage, they are helplessly passive witness. They're not able to do anymore anything.
Okay, we'll talk about that a little bit more. But Dr. Rajat Kathuria, if I may bring you in, and before I narrow it down further to India's concerns, if I look at the global picture, I just mentioned President Trump. And you know, he once famously said that climate change is essentially a Chinese conspiracy to tie down the US manufacturing sector. One of the first deeds that he did, or maybe call a misdeed that he did, was to pull out of the Climate Change Plan Accord in 2015, after he became president. So when you have the president of a superpower country behave like this, and this kind of an attitude on issues, he has literally been dismissing of climate change and global warming phenomena. Where do developing countries like India and its leadership then stand, and what are the responsibilities that then come and rest upon the rest of the world?
Thanks, Smita. I think that's a very interesting question. But before I sort of get into that, let me thank Sameer for inviting me here on what I think is an extremely important area. And sort of segue into what Smita just asked. You know, climate change, for a long time, not only in developed countries, but also in developing countries like India, we thought it was somebody else's problem. it wasn't our problem because it was in the nature of a what is called a global public good. And when you have a global public good, there's always a free rider problem. You say somebody else will take care of it, I don't want to take care of it. But what's happened recently and the examples that you have given is that it's not only a global public good to which every country should contribute, but it's also increasingly becoming a local public good. So, I mean, there are actions that we take that affect the environment here and now, and of course they affect the global public goods, the Amazon fires, etc. So we have a responsibility to contribute to both. And I think the first question that Sameer has asked in this sort of for this panel is the linkage between the 5 trillion economy and the trade-off therein to sort of achieving our climate goals. I think that this question should now not be asked at all, at least domestically. And there's a reason I say that, is that for a long time we believed that if we try and achieve climate goals, then it will trade off with our domestic goals because we are contributing to something that is global and it's trading off with GDP and jobs, etc. And I think that was a good argument to make maybe 15, 20 years ago. And it's still a good argument to make in international negotiations. So we should continue to make that, I mean, for technology transfer and finance that the rest of the world should give us. But I think for domestic political economy reasons, we should stop saying that there is a trade-off between our climate goals and our economic goals, because I think it's no longer a two-horse race. We to achieve the $5 trillion economy, and I think it's just an aspiration. We shouldn't look at $5 trillion as $5 trillion, but the fact that we are going to increase our GDP fast enough so that we can create jobs. But we should...
Are you suggesting that India has been more than giving on climate change issues globally so far now, and it's time that we became a little selfish?
No, exactly the opposite. I'm saying that we should stop saying that there is a trade-off between our domestic goals and our climate goals. We should, for our own sake, not for the international community's sake, there will be what co-benefits, right, for the international community. For our own sake, for the reasons that you mentioned, and for the reasons that Mr. Panda mentioned, that our people are increasingly vulnerable to the impacts of climate change, be it agriculture, be it warming, be it productivity, be it water, whatever you think of, is going to be, and who will be impacted? Just like in the international context, like Mr. Trump is saying, I mean, why is he so blasé about climate change? Because he knows they have the money to be able to deal with it. And they can, you know, invest in resilience. They can invest in adaptation. If they don't do mitigation, they can at least do adaptation. Just like that, within our country, within India, the rich have many more resources to be able to deal with climate change. We have air purifiers, we have water purifiers, we have air conditioners. We have all the goods that we can presumably, of course, there are some things that we can't take care of, but it's the poor that are increasingly vulnerable. And I think for the sake, we don't want to hide behind per capita numbers, right, all the time like we do. So what I'm saying is that whatever we do now for our development goals, climate should be mainstreamed there. And let me give you one example before I conclude. Is that when, you know, I've been associated with Indian policymakers for a long, long time and policy making. There was a time in India where only producer interests were taken care of in policy making. Only producer interests. Tariffs are high, protection is high, barriers to entry are high. After 91, consumer interests have now begun to find some resonance in policy making. Similarly, in policymaking today, I think it's climate goals that should increasingly find resonance there, and we should mainstream that. We should not think about growth and development without looking at the environmental impacts. That's the point I'm making.
Very significant, very important points out there. But then coming to you, Jay Chima, I mean, how do you reconcile these issues then? Here you are talking about, you know, and Dr. Rajat Kathuria did mention about the gap between the rich and the poor. And it's it's really a very small percentage that you're looking at who can afford an air-conditioned room, a room purifier. For majority of people out there, I mean, Delhi every winter, or in fact more often, makes it to the headlines being called as the gas chamber. If you look at Maharashtra, almost 53,000 mangrove trees are to be cut down for the bullet train project. And already we are seeing what state Maharashtra is in currently with the flooding, with the Mithi River reduced, the Nadi Nala ban chuka hai. You know, your natural, the drainage systems have gone for a toss. The mangroves are already vanishing out there. In Uttarakhand, for the 12,000 crore project to improve road connectivity in the Hindu pilgrimage sites, they are also assessed to be having severe ecological impact and damages. How do you then reconcile between your needs, your wants, and how to go about it?
Thank you, Smita. Let me first thank Mr. Sameer Kocher for inviting me this morning to this session. while I was driving up here, I was reminded of a quote by Guy McPherson. And it says, and I quote, "If you think economy is more important than environment, if you think that the economy is more important than environment, try holding our breath while counting your money." So essentially, what are we going to look for in terms of balancing the act between development and achieving our climate goals for our own selves? Because I think the question is now, not as Dr. Rajat Kukriya was saying, in terms of what our diplomatic obligations are to the outer world. That's a part. That was our policy way back in the 70s, 80s, and the 90s. Today, we have committed ourselves to the Paris Agreement. Recently, a rule book has come out under the Paris Accord as well, which leads the processes and the procedures which each member country will follow. But more than that, I think let's come back home and see what our constitution and our Supreme Court has been saying on this subject for a long, long time. The Supreme, this subject basically falls under the concurrent list, which is the seventh schedule of the Constitution, list three. And I think primarily under item 17A and 17B, and I think it is interspersed somewhere in the central list and in the state list as well. Therefore, you find that there is a multiplicity of both the state governments as well as the central government in terms of meeting some of the standards and processes that you need to follow. Okay. Having said that, that is what our constitutional framework is. What has Supreme Court has been saying since M.C. Mehta versus Union of India way back in early 90s, and more recently, there has been a judgment in M.C. Mehta versus Kamal Nath. The doctrine of public trust has been propounded under this ruling of the Supreme Court, which basically says that Article 21 of the Constitution, see, we all are familiar with Article 21 of the Constitution, which means life and liberty of every citizen. Reading into this right of Article 21 of the Constitution is what Supreme Court in 2013 has said is the right of forests, animals, water, plants, the habitat. All those rights are also enshrined in Article 21 and extending that right to all these other flora and fauna across the globe. So doctrine of public trust. So the government today has to balance between the doctrine of public trust, because they are holding all of these national assets as public trustees. And when they devise a policy on the manufacturing side or service side or developing industrial policy for the state. So let's be very clear that there has to be a fine balance between the two. I was talking while we were having coffee that what really sort of derails the development process, because this question is pertaining to your 5 trillion economy. Now what derails all this is essentially that there is no comprehensive package. And there's an example which we have in our energy sector, where we have done something to that extent which needs to be sort of looked at as a model for other projects that we do, is that we go ahead, we approve a project, There's a fast track in terms of central government approvals. I'm sure state governments looking at the development objectives of their states also go ahead and sort of approve the projects. Then comes the real brass tacks of establishing that industry or a manufacturing unit at some local place in a particular local. The real problem starts there, okay? Your pollution control board people, the local thugs, the local I won't say politicians, but I would say the local lords, so to say, the kind of interference that comes from them. I'm being very candid. I'm a lawyer, so I'm going to be very candid in this. So I think this whole process needs to be sort of also corrected. We see in the energy
But would you say that most of it is actually politically motivated or based on lies, or a lot of it is genuine concern coming in from the locals?
I think there may be a fair bit of sort of truth in some of the stuff which comes out, but I think a lot of it is motivated also. We have seen the kind of PILs that have been filed before the Supreme Court as well as before the National Green Tribunal. And I think a lot of them, then once the judgment comes out, shows a different shade.
So, fair enough. You were saying that there are also concerns of the industries. Not everything is embroiled in sort of adversities when it comes to the ecological balance.
Sure.
But a lot of it is caught in a lot of legal frameworks that need to be clarified. Dr. Arvind Kumar, coming to you now. You know, when you talk about water, and you've been doing a lot of work on water, we hear so much, but the basic right of safe drinking water is something that is still, not available to most Indians. I mean, I stay in a posh colony in Noida, and the quality of water that I get in Noida, I mean, I keep, joking with my stylists, ki aap please mujhe ek wig gift kar dein, because in Noida water, nothing is going to survive. That's a very specific point. But what I'm trying to make is, you know, when you talk about the water challenges and the larger climate change goals, are they reflecting in the budgets of the government? And are they translating down in terms of the awareness level to the common people?
Well, good morning, everybody. Water is an important subject. And 1/3 of climate is water. And in our country, the basic problem is that water is a state subject. Environment is in concurrent list and central list. So to balance in water and environment is very typical thing actually. And one more thing to add about the climate change, because the topic of discussion is climate change. Because of the climate change, the per capita of availability of water is actually reduced. If you see that data from 2050 see the data of 2019, the report of recent published report of Niti Aayog, per capita is actually reduced.
Major cities are, in fact, according to that report, are going to dry up by 2020. It's an alarming report. How vulnerable is India really when it comes to its water resources and the crisis at hand?
Actually, this is because not only the water sector, actually from the relative sector as well. If you see, after the first green revolution, actually the main concern is that how to extend our productivity. So at the time we are actually producing some amount of cereals, or we need some cereal because we are an agriculturalist country. But after the effect of this the green revolution, the most of the state, in fact the Haryana, some part of UP as well, Maharashtra, Northeast, the groundwater is actually fastly depleted. Almost 10 states in the country who have either no groundwater, you can say, groundwater, but no groundwater. So the reason is that we actually rely mostly on the pumping water, and we actually forget about the ancient kind of a lifestyle, like we are rely on our mainstream rivers and water bodies. So most of the, if you see the example of Delhi as well, once there was more than 2,000 water bodies in Delhi, but how many are existing here? So as a part of the wetland committee, National Wetland Committee, actually we are creating actually some rules as well. Now instructions goes to the state that there should be a need of relevant finance as well, so finance, technology, and If you actually raise the question about the Noida, in fact, Noida is passing through a river in between the two most important rivers, Ganga and Yamuna. But they don't have water because of the rapid urbanization. Some part of the country, rapid industrialization, without thinking about the if there is a water, or maybe they never thought about that there should be a big city should be here. Most of the migration, because people are migrated in search of the wages from the some part of the country to the almost three or four important cities. So the city, actually the system is disrupted.
I mean, you know, when you look at Karnataka today and the flooding pictures that come in, it's very difficult to believe that it's one of the driest states of India. But at the same time, there is no water harvesting that's happening despite the rains and the monsoon showers. You know, the question that I put forward to Jay, if you look at the Ken Bathwa, we hear a lot about the river linking projects. The Ken Bathwa river linking project supposedly will also destroy some 4,000 hectares of the Panna Tiger Reserve. So, is river linking a solution? Is it something that sounds good on paper, but really not something that is translatable into action?
Actually, before going to a serious discussion on the climate change relating to water, actually, what is climate change? Loss of biodiversity means extreme weather, sea level rising, extreme heat and drought. So, sustainable thinking, we have to think about. You think about the some other measures like rewilding, the carbon reset, about the adaptive measures, circular economy, polluter pay principle. It is not only the water water management. You can actually fill water somewhere so that your requirement for entire year will be fulfilled. You have to think actually other sectors too, like the rewilding means you just plant a tree and you think that your responsibility is enough. Means you have to think that, you have to imagine what kind of the world 50 years before. So you have to concentrate on all these things.
Right.
And your planning, if you talk about the 8 missions of the Government of India actually, they need to be revised accordingly.
So, before going to, in fact, Dr. Gushir and Mr. Pandey, you wanted to add something because there are a lot of public figures who talk about tree plantation constantly in plantation drive, but even those drives have their own set of problems. You know, that's not really an ecological solution.
As our esteemed colleague has said, that mega projects like combining rivers would have its own positive impact. The managing at the micro level water resources, especially because I know a friend of mine from University of Oxford has studied in Madras about the local water resource and the local water bodies, how they have been deteriorated, mismanaged and destroyed completely. That is adding to the depletion of the waterbed. Secondly, that is most of the waterbed are converted into like putting the garbage of the city or town. So this is a double jeopardy. Once you destroy the water resource, then you cause pollution. So this is added, you know, adverse complementarity. This is too, it's been a big challenge. People know it, but earlier, like I said, they used to attend to this, but they depend someone to come from the government side. And this is what is happening. And the micro level planning at the later local bodies, as panchayat, they don't give heed to anymore. This is one of the problems.
Okay, before I come to you, Dr. Gushiran, main bas ek audience se janna chahungi, aur agar aap, if you can just raise your hands in show of hands, aap mein se yahan kitne log hain jinke gharon mein climate change is phrase ke bare mein charcha hoti hai? Climate change ki awareness ko lekar. So it's not really much. आप में से कितने हैं जिनके घर में ये होता है कि भाई रिवर लिंकिंग होना चाहिए या नहीं? कौन कांग्रेस बीजेपी को सपोर्ट कर रहा है इसकी लड़ाई नहीं, लेकिन रिवर लिंकिंग पर कितने लोगों की बात होती है? ओके, सो आई जस्ट सी 3-4 हैंड्स. मैं ऑडियंस के बीच में आऊंगी, आप लोगों से सवाल भी लूंगी और कॉमेंट्स भी. डॉक्टर गुरशरण, नो
आई थिंक इफ यू लुक एट हिस्टोरिकली इन आवर कंट्री वी टॉक ऑफ दिस रिवर लिंकिंग प्रोजेक्ट. Look at what has been the kind of dispute that Karnataka and Tamil Nadu has been having on Krishna waters.
Yeah.
the kind of dispute between Punjab and Haryana on the SYL canal. Okay, I think you need to deep dive and really think through that how are you going to do this, because as Arvind was saying, it's a state subject. Water is a state subject. You know, it's a seven under, you know, item 17 under list 3. Now, how are you going to really, so you have to get all these states on board if you really want these natural resources to be equally shared amongst all. And I think some kind of equitable solution and rationality in terms of the states which are the upstream states, that they are not losing much of this water which they need for their own state. I think there's some kind of balancing, just like they have done in GST. I think some kind of national sort of forum where this could be discussed, and then a national policy to be developed, or maybe some regulations at the national level to be developed on this.
Okay. Thank you. Dr. Gusharan, you know, when we talk about micro planning, a lot of intentions, well-meaning intentions are announced, might look great on paper, but are they being thought through in terms of plan B, plan C, the different stages? I mean, look at something as basic and as important as stopping the use of single-use plastic. The Prime Minister has also set a target. There's a global target. The moment you say this, people like Mother Devi Boothwala, he'll say, I am raising the price of my product by 1 rupee or 2 rupee to make it. So when you are looking at these kind of announcements, what's the kind of preparation that needs to be done? And is it being done here in a country as diverse as India?
Well, thank you so much. This is quite a pertinent question. In fact, I would like to wind the clock a little back. As far as legal issues are concerned, implementation issues are concerned, whether it's a state subject or a central subject, the debate has always been on. We are not debating it for the first time. And whatever we are going to be seeing as a result of all these efforts, it's going to be another 5 to 10 or 15 years is anybody's guess. There has been a lot of mess. Now we can only guess as to what's going to happen next. But if we are discussing 5 trillion economy, how is it going to happen? 5 trillion economy is, I'm going to be presenting a contrarian view, so I run the risk of being misquoted and badgered very heavily.
By Sameer.
I don't know who.
By Sameer.
No. Not by him. I don't know. So what I mean to say is that while we are all, members on the panel agreeing that this remains an issue, I am going to be disagreeing. So that's the point of start. So that's the contrarian view. So, as I said, let's wind the clock back. If we look at how the 5 trillion economy is going to happen, it's going to be money. More money coming into the system. So if you got money, you are rich. If you haven't got money, you are poor. So translate it right from bottom till the top. So if the economy is to turn around, which is a sector which has been contributing a lot and also needs a push, to my mind, these are the micro and small and medium enterprises. Goes without saying, 36% contribution to GDP, more than 120 million employment, so on and so forth. The numbers are already there for everyone to understand. What are we doing about them? When we talk about climate change, we first do not talk about as to how do we protect the industry, protect the environment, and move forward. We say protect the environment at what cost? You gave the example of Mumbai Metro, the kind of disaster it has spelled. Take the example of Delhi Metro. At maximum advantage to which is given to the protection of the ecology and environment in Delhi, the project has been executed. And it was never debated that they caused any disaster. We are within the same country. So we need to have balance between our approaches, that what is it that needs to be done in the short term, what needs to be done in the medium as well as the long term. I'll give you another example. Now you talked about the plastic packaging. I give you the example of chemical as well. So what actually, in the wake of the global environment wherein the US and China, they got into a trade war, the rest is history. Everyone knows what's going on. But that has actually resulted in China stopping production of a few goods or otherwise relocating the industries, causing a vacuum. India has been doing very well in both these areas. One is plastic packaging, second is chemical production. I take it further. If that was the case, in the name of, you know, climate change, protection, so on and so forth, we say that chemical industry, which is thriving in the state of Gujarat, shut down. And these are largely 80% MSMEs. So what happens to them? It causes unemployment. It causes reduction in capacities. It also results in losing out on opportunities which by way of trade war between US and China being created to export. So not that everything is got to be consumed within the country. If that indeed was the case where it had to happen, they should have been relocated with the ready premises that in next 2 years you continue to operate from here, but have your transition plan so that we are able to capture the vacuum created in the global space and also get sensitive to our own ecology, environment, and have a smooth transition. Unfortunately, that wasn't done. So 80%, I'm giving you example only of one state. Now, this has been the case across chemical industry, across the country. Same goes for...
Who's to be blamed for that? I mean, is it the state government's policy? What is it then?
See, it's not a question of who is to be blamed. What I'm saying that when we say 5 trillion economy, this becomes a small, minuscule part which can actually contribute huge sums to it. So if we are going to be stopping it without giving relief, in the sense that giving them alternate opportunities so that the business does not stop, continues to grow, and over a period of time, we have safeguards which are built into the system by way of water, by way of environment, by way of legal, by way of global, everything put together.
Okay. I will, in fact, take one more question from Dr. Rajat Kathuria and then throw open the floor for questions. Koi Hindi mein bhi sawal puchna chahe, to please haath khade kar le. And I can see Dr. Sanjay Baru also there. I would definitely like to involve him in the conversation. Dr. Kathuria, you know the question that I was asking to one of the panelists earlier. When it comes to India's budget, do you see this priority reflected in our budgetary system? How much of a scope is there really for the budgetary allocations to be made towards what you want? If you're talking about rainwater harvesting, if you're talking about solar panels, I mean, India is taking a lead on International Solar Alliance, but when it comes down to the particulars, how many houses really can invest in a solar panel because of the cost factors? How do they reflect in India's budgetary concerns as well?
So I think the way climate action is reflected in the budget is through piecemeal initiatives rather than through a big vision of what we need to do to achieve our climate goals. And these piecemeal, hopefully they will add up in the future. Like as you said, investment in solar panels, giving up your LPGs, trying to institute behavioral change, all these things should add up. But what I also think what is reflected in this document that Sameer and team has prepared is that what has happened to the national plan on climate change, both at the center and then there are state levels. I mean, the state level plans have been completely dysfunctional, right? And so they need to add up to achieve the national level plan. Let me give you three examples of where I think there is a disconnect and why we need to take action. And there are difficult, hard choices to be made. As Mr. Arvind Kumar said, you know, water is going to become really scarce. And our per capita consumption availability is all going to plummet and we're going to, you know, hard times. We know that in India that 80% of our, correct me on the numbers, give or take a few percentage points, 80% of our fresh water is used by agriculture, right? And only 20% is used for consumption and industry. And out of that usage in agriculture, if you look at the states that consume a large percentage of their water, you will come up with, you know, maybe Maharashtra, which is a water scarce state, and Punjab, which is becoming a water scarce state. Now you're growing rice in Punjab, you're growing sugarcane in Maharashtra, and these are water guzzling crops. So you produce 1 ton of rice and you're exporting 5,000 liters of water, et cetera, all those numbers. So the question is, should you be growing rice in Punjab? And you would suggest that, you would think that, no, I think we should try and transition. But it's a very difficult political choice to be made. It's extremely difficult. Should be growing rice in eastern India where, there's flooding and, there's so much of water. Should be now, but that transition is extremely difficult. You know, and these are just two examples. The third example that I want to give you is on, let's say, coal, which the international community keeps talking about, how India should actually move away from coal and get into renewables. And it's probably a good suggestion, we should do it, but the problem is that's 50% of our energy, primary energy requirements are going to be met from coal. And that coal deposits, if not imported, are in India under forest cover. So if we are going to mine coal, we are going to destroy a lot of our forests. And the question is that how do you make that transition away from coal into renewables and other sort of renewable sources and move away from coal? That transition is going to be extremely hard and extremely disruptive. But the way we can do it, as Gurusharan has suggested, is that we need to plan for it. If you're going to disrupt your chemical industry, you need to plan for it. And that's where those national action plan on climate change and the state action plan on climate change become relevant. And therefore, you should have a social security architecture so that you can plan for that change. If you do it piecemeal, then the disruption costs are going to be extremely high, as we've seen in India.
Okay, so in an age driven by global disruptors, you need to find coherence and a vision somewhere. For those of you who have a question, you can please raise your hand. There's a gentleman here with a mic in hand. Kisi ke paas sawal hai? Wo piche, there's a lady there. The last seat there. Here.
Where is this side?
The lady there. Maybe somebody else can also be with a mic on this side. It'll be easier. Can one more person please come in on the floor with another mic? First, the lady there. Just keep the question specific, and to whom would you want to point it to?
So this is a straightforward question I would like to ask. I am from Karnataka. I am Shobha, finance officer. See, this is the fact that we are going for the $5 trillion transformation. The same time, we are also facing the problems of climate changes, and that is impacting on the economy. This is the fact. But at the same time, we have to address both. So in Karnataka, as all of us know, so till now, there is a crisis on economy towards the affected area, climate affected area, where we have got a floods and all. We don't have a assistance from the center. I feel that this is not today it is happening. This is happening from past 5 years. I can say this from past 6 or 7 years. This impact is already studied. Then also, why not we can take up a strong policy of protecting our poor people first and then looking into the development of economy?
Okay, so that's a fair enough comment. In fact, Dr. Arvind, would you like to talk about it? Also, if I could add to it, you're looking at people who are in drought-prone area, the communities. How do you help them build resilience? Along with also when you're talking about a place like Karnataka, which has coastal areas too. So that faces threat from the coastal areas too. So, the lady's comment about how do you really sort of reconcile these differences?
Emphasizing about the 5 trillion economy actually means you are shifting from some kind of economy to the green economy actually. So there is actually gap of $280 billion for next 5 years. To change over from fossil fuel to the green technologies and others to, in fact, in next 5 years, actually you required 50 lakh crore for railways, for aviation, for 3.5 lakh crore for water infrastructure as well, actually. So economy means you are creating kind of a structure, kind of a, actually, we are talking about entire country facing drought, flood, and economic downturn as well. So how can we come out from this? When we talk about the relevant technologies, especially the green technology, so we require fund, we require potential, we require local solutions, like we did in Meghalaya actually. Just add some point, last 10 years we are working in Meghalaya. And in Meghalaya, we actually took three strategies. Regionally, nationally, and locally as well. This is called Integrated Basin Development and Livelihood Mission. So we created 22 missions, and this is a Mission Green as well, we took it. And you believe, for actually we started in 2013. In 2018, the entire economy of the Meghalaya doubled. So on the same line, Government of India, we also suggested to Government of India as well. So you have to use the local potential. You have to actually understand the local strength, and use locally, any global ideas, local working.
Okay.
Yeah.
The gentleman there has a question. Before your question, if I can just get a comment from Dr. Sanjay Baru. No, because you know, you've somebody who's seen policy making from the inside. When it comes to the cooperative federalism structure and the issues that have been raised by panelists here about the states having their separate laws on a lot of issues, the center having us, and when you're in a constant state of political conflict, how do you turn that into cooperation? What is the biggest hurdle that you feel today is in the area? Dr. Baru, if I could just have a quick comment from you.
Well, frankly, there's not much of a hurdle. Most state governments are run by the same political party
today
that runs the central government. So I don't see why there should be a hurdle. But precisely because we are a federation, we created two important federal institutions which need to be revived. One was the Planning Commission, which was a federal institution in the way it evolved. And the second was the National Development Council. I don't think in the last five and a half years the NDC has ever met. The NDC was an important forum in which chief ministers and the central ministers could meet and talk about national problems. So you need to revive these federal institutions. And as far as the politics of governance is concerned, there should be no problem. Most state governments are run by the same party that runs the center.
Yes, yeah, so over the next few years at least, that definitely shouldn't be a problem. The gentleman there, you had a question, sir. And then the gentleman in the back row also had a question, yeah. We have 15 minutes, so please keep your questions a little specific.
Namaskar, main Chima sahab se janna chahta hoon. Jab hum national interest ki baat kar rahe hain aur climate change ek aisa subject hai jisme India ke sare states ka climate alag alag hai aur ek jagah kuch gadbad hoti hai to dusri jagah wo shift uska impact padta hai aur jab hum rules ya kuch aur regulations banane ki baat karte hain to fir hum state government ki taraf dekhte hain aur the एकमात्र रास्ता जो हमारी तरफ होता है हमारे पास होता है वो होता है कि कोई कोऑर्डिनेशन कमेटी या प्लानिंग कमीशन के थ्रू इंस्टीट्यूट्स को बुलवाना और उनसे सीएम्स को बुलवाना और सबसे इनसे बातचीत करना तो इज देयर एनी प्रॉब्लम कि हम उसको जो है वो स्टेट लिस्ट से निकाल कर इस तरह के उसको हम कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनली सेंट्रल लिस्ट में हम उसको डालें जबकि इतना बड़ा ये टॉपिक है और इतनी इस पर समस्या आ रही है तो हम इसको सीधे सीधे नेशनल इंटरेस्ट का टॉपिक है इसको सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट में हम क्यों नहीं शिफ्ट कर सकते
थैंक यू फॉर योर क्वेश्चन आई थिंक वी हैव टू लुक एट दिस इशू सो फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल लेट मी से दैट इफ यू आस्क मी द काइंड ऑफ लेजिस्लेशन विच आर टुडे एग्जिस्टिंग इन दिस स्फीयर नेशनली बोथ इन टर्म्स ऑफ एक्ट्स रेगुलेशंस पॉलिसीज मिशंस प्रोग्राम्स एंड इन द स्टेट I think there is enough in the rule book which is available. Okay, I think what we need to do is we need to rationalize all of this. There are too many things said at different places. And I think a comprehensive national policy, see, we are on the 5 trillion economy question. I think it's very important to understand that energy is going to play a big role in getting us to that 5 trillion number. Okay, now until and unless you do some climate mitigation in energy space, you are never going to be having this fine balance where you follow the doctrine of public trust which the Supreme Court had imposed on you as the central government and the state government. Obligation is on both. Now, so it's important that what do we do in terms of climate mitigation in the energy space if we want to get to that 5 trillion number? Because uske sabke liye energy is going to be a big pivot. Okay? I think government has now woken up. I think there is also a mixed bit of a confusion on EVs and solar and gas. Okay, for example, EVs for two-wheelers and three-wheelers and LNG as a fuel for trucking, for state bus transport corporations, for railways. I think we should look at some of these options. And today, now, recently, more recently, I think Tatas have developed a bus in hydrogen space, hydrogen as a fuel. You know, this is all going to help you in terms of climate mitigation. But mind it, for LNG, we had done some groundwork in that space in terms of legislative support. to the state government of Kerala at the point when they launched the first LNG bus in Kochi in 2017. Nothing much has moved by the state government since then. That's a different question altogether. But today we need to also bring in place legislation for bringing hydrogen as a fuel. Okay, so I think all of this is going to help us in terms of climate mitigation. And I think this needs a more comprehensive national holistic policy where we take, as Mr. Baru was saying, taking the state government's view, encompass it in our policy. And then I think we all are on board on a singular mission to bring a balance between development on one side and climate change on the other.
Jay, let me just ask you a little controversial question. Unki seedha se sawal pooch rahi hu, seedha se jawab dijiyega. Agar aaj aap ek mantri hote, kyunki abhi jo ek daur chala hai ki bhai rajya union territories ban ja rahi hain, kya states ke kuch powers ko aap center ke list mein le aate climate change se deal karne ke liye, concurrent list se, kya unko central list mein lane ki aap koshishe karte hain, kya uski zarurat hai jo unhone shayad sawal poocha abhi?
I understand from where you are asking that question from. I think let's de-alienate that issue altogether. I think we have a very robust federal structure which is time tested. Okay, the example that you are wanting me to say about, I think
that I'm being mischievous here, but the straight question is, you know, are there some powers of the state that need to be now resting with the center?
I think there is already a fundamental rule that if the central government legislates on something on which the state government has already, so the central rule prevails. There is already a rule to that effect. Okay. There are judgments to that effect. So I don't think there is a concern there. This federal structure has functioned very well for us. I don't think there is any need to do this in terms of just doing this climate change business. Right. I think we are a mature economy. We are a mature nation. And I think we have mature leadership at various levels. And I think we can bring all of them together to bring a comprehensive national policy.
That's a positive way of looking at things. We'll take two questions and then take the answers.
I'm very thankful to the dais for giving me opportunity. So I am a geographer and a professional cartographer and working in a natural resource data management system. So there is a climate change. Lithosphere, hydrosphere, and atmosphere, these three components are determines the biosphere. If we are going to disturb, definitely it will reflect on our biosphere. So in our India, we have a lot of geographical phenomena. Even developed country also not having that kind of phenomena. We have a plain plateau mountain, peninsular, and also perennial, non-perennial river, and two coastal areas. And the main thing is we have
a specific question. Running short of time now.
So we are facing some scarcity somewhere and flooding somewhere. So yeah. That is a linkage of a river is a very good project for to develop a socio-economical development of the society. So that's my advice.
Thank you, sir. Fair enough. Well taken. You think river linking should happen? The gentleman here.
I would like to say something.
I'm Suresh Kumar.
Dr. Gushiran would like to reply.
You know, again, I'll digress the discussion onto something which is micro. So we talked about solar alliance and something which the Honorable Minister spoke in the morning, very relevant. He said that we have to be owners of innovation rather than consumers of innovation. Does it mean to say that India as a country had stopped to innovate? The answer is no. But it's just that the innovation, which is what we are doing, we are not even consuming it. I give you a very, very small example here. We talk about cold storage industry. As we grow, there is going to be a huge potential and a huge opportunity for cold storage system. And there are companies, not one, two, three, there are several of them using solar energy. They have created a technology which is called solar cold storage chain. Now that is 3 to 4 times more expensive than the conventional cold storage system. There are no takers. What are we doing about it? We are killing innovation at the same time when we are saying that go solar. So that's one example. Second example is another big innovation we did about 3 to 4 years ago by introducing these solar rickshaws. And also they got converted into a battery operated rickshaws. Now, a huge innovation which provided employment opportunities to millions of Indians across category A, B, and C towns. But one small bit was missing. They were all using acid batteries. And till date, they do. After 2 years of cycle, there are millions of batteries lying outside. What are we doing about it? Why have we killed one innovation by stopping to get into something which would have protected our environment? Number three, talk global. Now, China, always we go back to China. Why? Because they have created the best practices to be emulated by others. And why do we have to lag behind each time when we talk about it? One very, very small point I'll make there. China, looking at the batteries and the EVs over next 4 years, 2014, they have a roadmap. And the largest EV manufacturer, I don't have to name, Tesla, has gone to China. Why not India?
So I'll just take two questions now because we're running a little short of time.
I'm Suresh Kumar. Regarding the climate change, I'm from Kerala. See, the central policy regarding, for example, in Western Ghats, there is a policy which now everybody knows that we had 2 years of flood and destruction. So in 2013, Western Gadgil has given a report. Then another report was there in Kasturirangan report. But these reports, there is not a single powerful agency to implement what are the good things in that report. At least start implementing. That was the lack which affected this kind of destruction. So is the government, either central, you said the federal structure is there, but in specific cases, can the central government and the state government make sure that such calamities do not occur and these type of reports shall be implemented in a time frame manner?
Thank you, sir. We'll take one more question and then I'll ask the panelists to take it. And the gentleman there also has a question.
Yes, sir. Good afternoon, madam. Hum $5 trillion ki baat kar rahe hain. Abhi last 20 years mein 40 to 50 degree temperature pahunch gaya hai. To agar hum 5 trillion pahunchte kahin 60 degree pahunch jayenge to kya karenge?
60 trillion
degree.
Achha, 60 degrees. Temperature. Ki 5 trillion ka cost kahin 60 degree temperature na ban jaye. Fair enough question. I'll take a last question and then we'll take the answers from all the panelists. Can you give the other mic, please?
Yeah, my question is related to both 5 trillion and the environment. You know, it's presumable that, you know, when we are talking about 5 trillion economy, a lot of resources will be used either in the manufacturing sector or others. I'm happy that here Mr. Chima has mentioned energy as one of them. Now, polluters pay is one slogan which we have heard and it is being implemented in parts. Does circular economy play a significant role, or do we have to look at circular economy when we are talking about 5 trillion and at the same time trying to maintain our environment conditions, you know, as on date? Any okay. of the panel members?
So, Dr. Rajat, would you like to start with the last question?
Exactly. I think thank you for that question. I think you hit the nail on the head. And in fact, that was the subtext of my first comment. That if you want to really achieve 5 trillion, I think 5 trillion, if I could say, as I said in my initial remarks, it's an aspiration. Matlab usme hame obsess nahi hona chahiye ki 5 trillion karna hai ya 10 trillion karna hai. We should keep that as an aspiration, because you know the past narrative has been when you grow, you will, you know, damage the environment. Wo to hoga hi, that damage to the environment will happen. Even today, the damage to the environment. So as you're rightly saying, if we actually achieve 5 trillion, and if you look at our NDCs and pool them with global NDCs, the national determined contribution, then the world temperature is going to rise by 4 degrees Celsius by the end of this millennium. And then we are all going to be underwater, not only Bangladesh and Bombay and Kiribati and Pacific Islands and Maldives. Lot of us will be underwater, right? That's we know that's already begun to happen. So I think that 5 trillion number should be an aspiration and not a goal that we want to achieve at any cost, because we have to, as I said, mainstream the argument that
we have to achieve our climate goals concurrently. And if you do the math, if we achieve 5 trillion by numbers without taking care of the environment, then I think the health cost, the damages that we are going to cause to the ecology is going to be much more.
Right.
So what is the answer? The answer is the circular economy, exactly. And what is the circular economy? We have to, our solid waste, very little of it needs to go to the landfill. The clothes that we wear should not be thrown away, should be given to people. And India is a great example, not by design, but by circumstance, where we are actually implementing the circular economy. Because we are a poor nation, and by circumstance, we actually recycle much more than what other countries do. But we have to mainstream this. If we don't mainstream this, apart from, you know, what is going to cause to the global environment, it will become almost impossible for us to survive within the country because of the damage that we cause to agriculture and our ecosystem. So the point I was making, and I think I'm glad you've asked this question, the point I was making is that from now on, when we plan, if we are going to plan a coal plant or if we are going to plan a chemical plant, what we should do is to actually see what the consequences of that are going to be, internalize those, and then go for it. Whether it's going to be clean coal, whether there's going to be resilience, we have to internalize those. And the last point I want to make, if you indulge me, is that, you know, often people say that to be able to implement the social security architecture, we will need it, because there will be sort of displacement, there will be joblessness, etc. So we need to plan for that, and we need to reskill, but the transition is going to be difficult. Often people say that the government of India does not have the fiscal space to do it, and that is, I think, today discussion that is happening in the media, in the newspapers, amongst think tanks, amongst the government as well. How does the government create fiscal space? And I think an answer to that, a long-term answer, not a short-term answer, a long-term answer to creating fiscal space for the government is, I think we have to, and Mrs. Nirmala Sitharaman has said this, we need to improve the quality of the revenue that we get. We have to improve the quality of our tax administration. Our tax to GDP ratio has to go up to 20%.
Okay.
Once that happens, I think we'll be able to address a number of these issues.
Right. I'll just ask Mr. Panda to answer the gentleman from Kerala who raised the question about reports that get dumped and go into the coal bags, along with also the good points in those reports.
If we look at the...
The mic a little closer, sir.
If we look at the Indian subcontinent, it has different ecological zones, be it Western Ghat or Eastern Ghat, and each region has its own risk and uncertainty so far as climate change is concerned. Now, when we, as Katoria was talking about the 5 trillion, which is aspirational, that means that we aspire, but what is now necessity is that to prevent the, you know, further damage of the climatic conditions. So that is the urgent imperative. That is, we can work out. But unfortunately, when we aspire for certain 5 trillion or whatever amount, it has various aspects which has a direct impact on the ecological change and climate change. So what we have to do is that when we divide among the ecological zones in the country, each state within the federal setup we have should come up with their own sectors, vis-a-vis the center also come up with the mining, industries, railway, all these sectors should proactively think as to what project they are taking and how much adverse conditions they are going to cause in terms of ecological degradation. And if this degradation had to be mitigated, what kind of resource to be mobilized from their own resources so that we have a charter across the sectors to see that this sector would cause this much of impact and this would require this much of efforts and resources. So that is to be ensured first when you are going to it,
right.
You know, 5 trillion.
Okay, I'll just last take two last comments from our fellow panelists. Dr. Arvind Kumar, your final thoughts as we close the session, and especially when you talk about water. I mean, we hear a lot about desalination happening, sea mein, lekin usko paani ko pahunchaye kaise? Wo water transportation ka cost kahan se aayega, resources kahan se aayegi? In tarah ki cheezon par kis tarah ki planning ki zarurat hai jo shayad is waqt nahi hai?
मैं पहले कुछ कुछ चीज़ों को जो बीच में सवाल उठे थे उनका भी जवाब दे
थोड़ा संक्षेप
हाँ संक्षेप में मैं डीप नहीं जाना चाहता जिस तरह के आपने पूछा था कि क्या स्टेट की जिम्मेदारियाँ हैं क्या सेंटर की जिम्मेदारियाँ हैं मेघालय में जो मॉडल डेवलप हुआ वो 5 कंट्री के बीच में हुआ तो कई बार कंट्री टू कंट्री जो है वो भी लोकल होता है लोकलाइज सोल्यूशन अगर मेघालय में कोई दिक्कत है वो भूटान बांग्लादेश के साथ में करेगा तो जो कंट्रीज थी उसने अपनी नीड को पूरा करा देन दूसरे कंट्री जो नेबरिंग कंट्री थे अब तो आप किस चीज़ में थे छोटी छोटी चीज़ें फ्लोरिकल्चर था तो छोटी छोटी चीज़ें जो कि MSME वाली चीज़ें थी उनको प्रमोट किया लोगों की इनकम बढ़ाई तो $5 trillion की इकॉनमी हम जब अचीव करेंगे कैपेसिटी बिल्डिंग करके टेक्नोलॉजी का इंप्रूवमेंट करके और लोकल सोल्यूशन लोकली करके अब वो चाहे दो स्टेट के बीच में हो सकता है दो कंट्री के बीच में भी हो सकता है और 5 कंट्री के बीच में भी हो सकता है दूसरा डिसेलिनेशन पे जो बात है डिसेलिनेशन की प्रॉब्लम सबसे बड़ी है कि उसके अभी तक कॉस्ट ज़्यादा थी लेकिन जिस तरह से ग्रीन एनर्जी का आप देख रहे हैं कॉस्ट डाउन जा रही है वो सबसे चीपेस्ट वे होगा आने वाले टाइम में और 200 किलोमीटर तो हम पाइपलाइंस तक पहुँचा सकते हैं इतनी बड़ी हमारे पे कोस्टल लाइन है हमारे पास जो है तो आने वाले टाइम में बहुत अच्छा सोल्यूशन ये बन सकता है पहले नहीं था अब हो सकता है वो जो थैंक यू
जे फाइनल कमेंट्स फ्रॉम यू योर थॉट्स एंड ऑल्सो द फैक्ट ई वेस्ट का जिक्र किया गुरशरण ने आप जब क्लाइमेट चेंज की बात करते हैं इंडस्ट्रियल प्रोडक्शन की बात करते हैं आर देयर स्ट्रिंजेंट लॉज इनफ टू इंश्योर रिस्पॉन्सिबल डिस्पोजल ऑफ वेस्ट इज द लॉज लैकिंग और इज इट समथिंग दैट नीड्स टू बी इंसेंटिवाइज्ड
ओके डीलिंग विद द फर्स्ट क्वेश्चन फर्स्ट I think my parting comments are that technology and innovation, I think, will drive the way in terms of climate mitigation. I think that's the first point that I want to make. The second point that I want to make is that we already have the constitutional and the legal framework and the judicial pronouncements in place. The government is aware of it, lawyers are aware of it, the administrators are aware of it. I think whatever we need to do in terms of developing a national policy on any of the subjects, as one of the 8 missions, somebody mentioned that they are obsolete, they need to be looked at again. I think all of that should be looked with a fresh look should be given in terms of what the judicial review has produced for us in terms of pronouncements, so that we are in line in terms of thinking nationally on that subject. Third thing is, so the constitutional test has to be met. I think technology and innovation has to come in for climate mitigation. I think that is the only solution, both in terms of the manufacturing sector as well as in terms of emissions, which is going to be the biggest challenge for us. One thing what Dr. Kathuria was saying, I think we are an agriculture-based economy. I don't think we can ever think of reducing or damaging the crop producing land that we have in this country. So whatever we need to do in that space, I think we need to do that, because if that happens, then food will be a big issue. We are not, a lot of people below the poverty line currently, so the food will be a big issue. Now, the third was the e-waste management, as you said. And I think I quite agree with sir, that, you know, in terms of today, now we're talking about lithium batteries, okay? As a solution for EVs, and you know, I think the two-wheeler companies have been asked to produce models, and I think some of them have produced them as well. We're thinking of large batteries and charging stations and blah blah blah. Has anybody thought about how you're going to manage this waste? This is going to be a tremendous amount of waste that is going to be produced. I think we need to strengthen that sphere. I think there is something lacking there. I think that those are my parting thoughts.
Last comments from Gushiran. You know, and especially, how do you ensure that the climate change technology is made affordable for people out there? You know, for people who can afford a solar panel, people who can go in for rainwater harvesting. How do you ensure that for a country like India?
That's again a very relevant question, but let me go again a step further. We have been discussing 5 trillion economy and the role climate change is going to be making there. We have touched upon almost all the aspects, and when you asked as to how many people in the house actually will have their hands raised up when we discuss climate change, and there were barely 3 or 4 of them. This is, I don't know to call it a fortunate or unfortunate situation, because most of the people in the house today, they belong to the state governments, and a few even from the central government. So when we have the administrators, the implementers, you know, the owners of the projects representing various states, even they do not have complete overview as to what climate change is all about, what policies, what implementation, what state subject, what central subject is going to do. So the very first starting point to absorb all these innovations is going to be the capacity building of the people who are running the government, both at the state as well as the central level. So if I ask one question, all over again, as to what are the three basic tenets of the International Solar Alliance that was set up in 2014? Can I have a few hands going up?
International Solar Alliance ke baare mein kitne logon ne suna ya jankari hai?
1, 2, 3.
So again, 5 people.
So why is it that entire knowledge has to be limited to 5 people sitting on a stage and discussing the subject with you? Why is it that we cannot participate in a dialogue so that we also have your inputs and a concrete actionable outcome from the discussion, whether this one or any other at any other forum?
I think that's a good comment to end this discussion with, and I think it's forums like SKOCH that help take forward this dialogue. But just extracting the larger essence of this conversation, climate change today is the biggest threat. I would say it's a threat bigger than terrorism, because terrorism mein jo log mare jaate hain wo visible hote hain. Climate change makes for faceless people and faceless communities. Jo log displaced ho rahe hain, jin logon ki jaane ja rahi hain. So which is why we all need to be very alert, we all need to be very sensitive. Hum logon ko liye zaruri hai ki climate change par hum environment par paryavaran par apne gharon mein charcha kare, bachchon ke sath charcha kare, taki hum agar charcha karenge, and if we are aware about the issues, then we can hold the governments and authorities accountable as to, you know, the big figures that you announce in budgets or on papers, what's really happening, where is the trickle down factor, are you looking at the nuts and bolts of the issues or not as well, are you just rolling out plans, bulldozing plans without thinking of plan B and C of the larger communities at stake. And I think as individuals, all of us need to also be very responsible about environment when we talk about community, about climate change. I love the color green. Go green, mission green. That should be an individual slogan for all of us. Reuse, recycle, discriminate between your needs and your wants. Be responsible, dispose your waste responsibly. And let's all hope that we can take forward this conversation. Aur jaisa un shakhs ne kaha ki kahin aisa na ho ki $5 trillion ke chakkar mein para 60 degree ka ho jaye. उम्मीद करते हैं ऐसा ना हो. कमरे में मुझे लगता है अभी 40 डिग्री हो गया है 12, तो थोड़ा सा एक ब्रेक भी होना चाहिए अगले सेशन के पहले. सो थैंक यू सो मच ऑल ऑफ यू फॉर जॉइनिंग अस, ऑल द पैनलिस्ट्स एंड ऑल ऑफ यू एज वेल फॉर जॉइनिंग इन द सेशन.